we have different classes of antiplatelet drugs. Important that all of them act on platelets and all of them inhibit aggregation in primary hemostasis. But each class has its own mechanism of action. So to explain their mechanism of action, we have to briefly recall hemostasis. So if damage to endothelial cell occurs, endothelin that was contained inside the endothelial cell will be released into the bloodstream and will cause transient vasoconstriction. After vasoconstriction, organism has to immediately cover and repair the damaged area. In order to do this, endothelial cells release from viable polar bodies huge amount of von Willebrand factor. In the bloodstream, von Willebrand factor binds to subendothelial collagen under the disrupted endothelial cell. After that, platelets come to the site of injury, and by the specific receptor GP1b, they bind to von Willebrand factor. And exactly this simple step called platelets adhesion. After the adhesion, platelets become activated. In response to this, they undergo shape change that results in their degranulation. With degranulation, platelets release the content inside them, including the dense granules that contain ADP. ADP that is released into the blood acts on ADP receptor on platelets and activates it. Activation of ADP receptor forces platelets to transport GP2B3A receptor to the surface, where GP2B3A serves as binding site for fibrinogen. In addition to this, platelets from prostaglandins by COX enzyme begin to produce thromboxane A2, and the function of thromboxane A2 is to promote aggregation. When fibrinogen notice a GP2B3A receptor on platelet surface, fibrinogen immediately binds to GP2B3A, and when another platelet comes to the site of injury, platelet immediately binds by GP2B3A to fibrinogen, and this process is significantly accelerated by thromboxane A2. This binding occurs over and over again until platelet plaque will be formed, and exactly this gathering of platelets at the site of injury called aggregation, and aggregation results in formation of a platelet plaque. But platelet plaque is weak, and to stabilize it, to make it formidable, we have secondary hemostasis. The function of the secondary hemostasis is to make from weak platelet plaque a formidable structure that's called thrombus. And the thing that makes this platelet plaque formidable is conversion of unstable fibrinogen into a stable fibrin. Secondary hemostasis is provided by coagulation factors that form coagulation cascade. The central factor of coagulation cascade is factor 10. The goal of both intrinsic and extrinsic coagulation pathways is to activate factor 10. Intrinsic pathway consists of factors from 12 to 8. Extrinsic pathway consists of just factor 7. Activation of factor 10 results in activation of factors 5, 2 and 1. Factor 2 called prothrombin that with activation becomes thrombin. And factor 1 called fibrinogen that with activation becomes fibrin. And exactly fibrin makes from platelet plaque a formidable thrombus. So secondary hemostasis converts platelet plaque into a thrombus. To assess the extrinsic pathway, we use prothrombin time and international normalized ratio. For assessment of intrinsic pathway, we use partial thromboplastin time. The first class of drugs called ADP antagonists. As an example, let's take clopidogrel, which is very popular medication nowadays. The major principle here is that clopidogrel blocks ADP receptor, so-called P2Y12 receptor. So this receptor becomes inactive. Because of that, ADP that is released from the platelet cannot activate ADP receptor. Without activation of ADP receptor, platelets cannot force transportation of GP2B3A into the platelet surface. So fibrinogen cannot bind to platelets. As a result, platelet-to-platelet aggregation becomes impossible, and thereby platelet plaque and subsequently thrombus cannot be formed. ADP inhibitors are very popular drugs. They are used in treatment of acute coronary syndrome or in a patient with coronary stenting. Mostly clopidogrel is used together with aspirin, and we call such therapy dual antiplatelet therapy. The side effects of ADP inhibitors are rare, but we have to know that ticlopidine can cause neutropenia, and also potentially they can provoke thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. The next class of drugs called GP2B3A inhibitors. These drugs block GP2B3A receptor on activated platelet. Let's take Abciximab, which is monoclonal antibody. So what Abciximab is doing? Abciximab blocks GP2B3A receptor that is already present on a platelet surface. As a result, fibrinogen cannot bind to platelets, so platelet aggregation becomes impossible, and thereby platelet plaque and subsequently thrombus cannot be formed. GP2B3A inhibitors are used in case of percutaneous coronary intervention and in patients with unstable angina. The most common side effects are bleeding and thrombocytopenia. Another class of drugs is COX inhibitors. These drugs block COX enzyme and by this they inhibit aggregation. By far the most popular drug is aspirin. So when we prescribe aspirin, it blocks COX enzyme, and by this it decreases the production of thromboxane A2. Without thromboxane A2, aggregation becomes much slower, and the slower is the platelet-to-platelet aggregation, the slower occurs platelet plaque formation, and thereby the slower thrombus will be formed. Aspirin is used in acute coronary syndrome and for coronary stenting. The most important side effects of aspirin are gastric ulcers formation and renal injury. The next class of drugs called phosphodiesterase inhibitors. The most popular drug here is dipyridamole. What we have to know is that cyclic AMP significantly inhibit platelets function. The enzyme that regulates the amount of cyclic AMP inside the cell called phosphodiesterase. Phosphodiesterase degrades cyclic AMP into AMP. So when we prescribe dipyridamole, this drug inhibits phosphodiesterase, thereby degradation of cyclic AMP into AMP decrease, the level of cyclic AMP inside the platelet increase, and increase in cyclic AMP markedly inhibit platelet's function. So expression of GP2B3A receptor will decrease, as a result aggregation will decrease. Because aggregation decreases, platelet plaque formation will occur slower, and this decreases the risk of thrombotic events. The side effects of phosphodiesterase inhibitors are related to their vasodilation properties. The major problem is that it's non-selective drugs. This means that they act on entire organism and cause generalized vasodilation. On face it manifests with facial flushing. In relation to cardiovascular system, it causes hypotension. Relaxation of smooth muscles in GI tract cause abdominal pain and nausea. Because all these drugs inhibit just primary hemostasis, they all increase bleeding time. This means that with overdose, they can increase the chance of mucous membrane bleeding. It's bleeding from GI tract, bleeding during menstruation, they predispose to bleeding gums and nose bleeding, so-called epistaxis. Also, significant inhibition of primary hemostasis can cause microhemorrhages that on the skin manifest with petechia purpura chemosis. But very important that they do not affect secondary hemostasis, and because of that, prothrombin time, international normalized ratio, partial thromboplastin time will be completely normal. To reverse the effect of these drugs in case of severe overdose, we can prescribe platelet transfusion. So to summarize, ADP antagonists as clopidogrel block ADP receptor. GP2B3A inhibitors as Abciximab block GP2B3A receptor on a platelet surface. COX inhibitors as aspirin block COX enzyme and thereby they decrease the production of thromboxane A2. Phosphodiesterase inhibitors as dipyridamole block phosphodiesterase enzyme that cause increase in cyclic AMP and thereby they inhibit platelet activity. So all these medications have different sites of action, but they all act on platelet and they all inhibit aggregation. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!